I'm going to start with the introductions. Our featured speaker for this weekend is Richard Hayes. Richard is a friend of our library. He has done some marvelous things for our library and is a friend of mine personally. And the very fact that he is here this weekend is because of his friendship and appreciation of what we're doing here. And he keeps a very busy schedule. Dean of Duke Divinity School for a little while longer. One more year, and then he will be continuing his work and education beyond that, but not as the dean of the Divinity School. He's going to free up some of his time for other endeavors. He is an absolutely brilliant New Testament scholar with a great eye toward the Old Testament as well. He's written a number of different books, commentaries, and other things, but specifically, what we're about today is a book based on a set of lectures that he gave in Cambridge, wasn't it? And over a period of about a year, there was a set of lectures he gave, I believe it was 8 lectures or 6 lectures, and those ultimately were published by Baylor University in the book that we've got today. We're going to be discussing that book. I was having breakfast or lunch with Richard at Duke when he told me about this project of his, and I said, you got to come to the library and talk about that. And he said, I'd be honored to if we can work it into the schedule. And this is when we worked it in. He gave up his Memorial Day weekend to be here. So would you join me in welcoming Dean Richard Hayes? And take us, you're in the center, dead center. Also, we've got here Lynn Cohick. Dr. Lynn Cohick is a professor of New Testament studies at Wheaton College. She is also, we're excited, because she will be our featured speaker, I think it's in September, on her new commentary on Philippians. And she is our first woman's featured speaker at our library functions. And we did not invite her because she was a woman. We invited her because of who she is as a scholar and what she's done. She has a PhD in New Testament and Christian origins from the University of Pennsylvania. She's fresh to us from Chicago, has also given up her Memorial Day weekend to be with us. So would you join me in welcoming Dr. Lynn Cohick? Thank you, Lynn. And then perennial friend of the library, David Capes, who helped us get Dr. Lynn Cohick, is here as well. David has always been working so hard to help put this library into a place where it can be. And he's from the part of Christianity that is south of us called HBU, and has been at HBU for 20-some-odd years. 25 years, has a marvelous Bible translation out now of the New Testament called, it's the whole Bible? Tells you I've been reading it, doesn't it? Called, I need to read backwards through the Bible. That's very good. Anyway, has several new books coming out. If you don't know David Capes, you need to. He has changed my life and the work of the library here. So join me in welcoming David Capes. And then Carey Newman. Now, Carey comes to us from Waco, Texas, where he is the head of publishing for Baylor University Press, but he's also an active teacher. With his PhD from the university, or from Baylor University, and his master's from the University of Aberdeen, a scholar of New Testament and church history, who is here as well, and happens to be the publisher of Dean Hayes' book, Reading Backwards, which is the subject that we're going to be talking about here. Would you join me in welcoming Carey Newman? You get either seat, Carey. Now, panelists, here's the deal. I'm going to ask y'all questions, and you get one microphone. I'll just walk around. One microphone that you get to share. The key to the microphone is You won't realize it, but they cannot hear your voice because of these acoustics unless you sing or hold the microphone right up against your chin or mouth. So with that, we're going to start with you, Dean Hayes. Tell us briefly what your book is.
It's a study of the differing ways that each of the four gospel writers interprets the Old Testament, particularly with regard to how they draw on the Old Testament to interpret the significance and identity of the figure of Jesus. And the major finding or thesis of the book is that while they do it in quite different ways, they draw on different Old Testament texts, they have different strategies of interpretation, but they converge in this one important point that all of them regard Jesus as the embodiment of the God of Israel. Now, I often say that I spend a lot of my time as a New Testament scholar explaining to other New Testament scholars things that are perfectly obvious to most people in the churches. But in fact, if you read the literature in New Testament studies, you will find there's a very common view that it really isn't until you get to the Gospel of John, which is probably the latest of the four Gospels to be written, it isn't until you get to the Gospel of John that you have any notion of Jesus as divine or Jesus as being the incarnation of God. The argument is that the synoptic Gospels, particularly Mark and Luke, have what has been called in New Testament scholarship a low Christology. That is, that Jesus was a great prophet, a great teacher, that he was a martyr, he was a teacher of wisdom, but that it wasn't until at least a couple of generations after his death that you really began to have these stories being told that identified him as the embodiment of Israel's God. And I've tried to show in this book that that's simply wrong, that although they do it sometimes in subtle ways by evoking references to the Old Testament, that all four gospel writers do regard Jesus as the embodiment of God. And one of the points, which I hope we'll get into discussing later, is that that forces a pretty dramatic rethinking of what we mean when we use the word God. So that's what the book is about, Mark.
Okay, so I have a gentleman who has occasionally frequented our class, not often. And that's a class, for those of you who don't know, that I teach at Champion Forest Baptist Church. And he has told me and several of the other class members that he's read enough to know that Jesus's contemporaries and those immediately after him knew him to be nothing more than a good man. And if you read the three synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, if you read them carefully, you'll see that there's no claim ever made that Jesus is anything other than a good man. Now, your book addresses that, but give us just a thumbnail reaction.
Well, I think... first of all, that's wrong, but secondly, it's a view that can easily arise if one doesn't read the Gospels in the context of the Old Testament in Israel's scripture. So that when you have a story, as you do, let's say, in the Gospel of Mark, and by the way, Mark is one of the Gospels, it's usually thought to be the earliest of the Gospels, and it's usually thought to be the gospel that has the least in terms of any sort of claim about divine identity of Jesus. But when you read the Gospel of Mark, that you hear a story of Jesus stilling the storm, and the disciples who are in the boat say, "Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" There's only one possible answer to that question. Only one possible right answer to that question in the context of Israel's scripture. And you can read in the Psalms that God is the one who is sovereign over the wind and the sea and over the whole creation. So that's just one little example. And of course, the book gives many such examples. So there's no statement in that story, "Oh, therefore Jesus is God." or you don't have the disciples at that point bowing down and worshiping Jesus. In fact, Mark never tells a story where that happens, although you do get it in Matthew. Nonetheless, it's embedded in the logic of the story that Mark is leading, he's attempting to lead the readers subtly to recognize this mind-blowing claim that Jesus is the God of Israel. But the only way you recognize that is if you read that story in conversation with the Old Testament background.
Okay, we'll go to the Old Testament, but if you'll pass the microphone to Lynn, I want to ask her a question in this reference. And maybe before I do that, I should have asked you, if you can shout it out, date the Gospel of Mark for us, if that's the earliest gospel in your mind.
It's somewhere, I think, around the year 70, plus or minus 5 years.
Okay, thank you. Now, so if we've got the Gospel of Mark somewhere 65 to 75 AD. Lynn, you are a recent publisher with a commentary on Philippians. Date Philippians for us.
It would be earlier than the Gospel of Mark. That's what most people would claim.
And there's not really much dispute about that,
no.
Is there?
No.
Okay. Now, within the framework of that, are we able to look simply at Philippians itself and see whether or not the church in its early stages saw Jesus as deity?
I think that's the most straightforward way to read, especially the Christ hymn in chapter 2, that Paul is also expecting his congregations, not only in Philippi, but in Corinth, for example. We have one God and one Lord. There are various places. You would also look at 1 Corinthians 15. I mean, just places where Paul is clearly talking about what has been handed down to him, and Jesus is Lord.
All right, you referenced the Christ hymn in Philippians 2, 5 through 11 in that area. By Christ hymn, for those who may not know, these look to be lyrics that were sung by the early church that reference Jesus, although he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the... So if the church is singing about that, is this a gospel-infused church, or were the gospels, if written later, simply a creation that grew out of this Pauline movement, if you will?
Paul testifies, I think, to what the gospel writers also testify to. It's all coming from the same place. And Paul is writing to the Gentile churches that are not living in Judea or Galilee, but they are all saying the same thing. Because they're all witnessing to the same thing. At the end of the hymn, it talks about every tongue confessing, every knee bowing, every tongue confessing that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. And Paul is drawing on Isaiah there. And so it goes right back to your earlier point that both the Gospels and Paul are thinking about who Jesus is through Isaiah, through the books of Moses.
Okay. All right, if you'd pass the microphone, please, down to David. Now, David, as you know, starting in the fall, those of you who may not have a place to go to Sunday class, Champion Forest Baptist Church, we will be teaching what we're calling Life Group Greek. This is a chance to learn some basic Greek concepts that help us better understand the New Testament. Now, one of the things that we will probably explore in one of those lessons is the Greek word for Lord, Kurios. Now, Lynn has referenced the fact that in Philippians, Paul says, every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Kurios, Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Now, we read that word Kurios, Lord. Lord is a pretty straightforward word in the Hebrew Old Testament. Translated Kurios,
About 6,000 times, I think.
And who does it reference in the Old Testament?
Well, the divine name, Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, the unspeakable, ineffable name of God that is protected by one of the top 10 commandments, right? So that name comes across in the Greek version, which Richard points out in his book, was the Bible of the early Christians, the Greek version of the Old Testament. We often refer to that as the Septuagint. That name is translated or rendered, it's hard to know, is it translated, is it rendered into the word kurios. So every time you see the word kurios, not every time, but many times you see it, 6,000 times, you find that it is a reference to the unspeakable name of the one true God.
So,
and Paul takes that language and he appropriates Jesus, he links Jesus with that same language. So that that passage from Isaiah 45:23, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess, comes from the most stridently monotheistic passage in all of the Hebrew Scriptures, where it says over and over, I am the Lord, Yahweh, and there is no other. And that language now is being associated with Jesus. And Jesus is the one to whom knees ought to bow, to whom every tongue ought to confess that he is Lord.
Okay. Now, you've written on Paul. Rediscovering Paul, I think, is one of the many books you've got to your credit. In the process of this, have you tried to determine whether or not Paul, the trained rabbinical Jew, the Pharisee of Pharisees, saw and identified Jehovah God, to use a King James version of the Tetragrammaton, Jehovah God as Jesus in some incarnation?
Yeah, I would say yes. I think he does, and I've been criticized for using the word identifies, but he does in some way identify Jesus with God. Richard Baucom's language, I think, is really helpful, that Jesus has been included within the divine identity. And Richard's language is also helpful, that Jesus is understood as the embodiment of the God of Israel. And I think that's an amazing thing to happen within just a few years of the death and execution of Jesus.
All right.
This is even though Philippians was written, let's say, 62, maybe, these hymns and these confession and this teaching is non-controversial. Paul doesn't feel like he's got to explain it to anybody. It's sort of accepted by the church that this is language that is appropriate. And to sing this and to chant this is to the glory of God. That's how he concludes that hymn. So these hymns could go back a decade, perhaps two decades earlier. Martin Hingle makes the case that Paul is probably converted within 3 to 5 years of converted to Jesus, faith in Jesus, within 3 to 5 years of his execution, happened between 30 and 33. So that's pretty fast. This is not something that takes a generation or two to develop.
Yeah, we certainly know, at least by what Paul writes to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians 15, that there were hundreds of people still around who were witnesses to the resurrected Jesus at this time that he's doing that. Is that fair? I'm not making that up, am I?
I think it's in there.
Okay, good. All right, if you'd pass it to Carey. So, Carey, I want to ask you about this from a scholastic perspective, but before I do, I need to ask you as a publisher. So why is this noteworthy? Why does this need to be in the academic catalogs? Why explain to us what's going on? Why do you publish this?
There are noble reasons to publish it. It's a really good book, but beyond that, I did make a note as Richard was talking that Richard undersells his own thesis and its significance in some ways. There are more pernicious ways to understand the way in which Christianity developed, and especially the belief in Jesus as a God. And there are a large number of people who write and publish prolifically and whose books sell and are bought at the Barnes & Noble and at the airport bookstores.
Bart Ehrman. Yeah. Excuse me.
Yeah. whose books are bought at the airport bookstores. And, you know, Bart's going to argue that early belief in Jesus, the belief in Jesus as divine was a political decision imposed upon the church from Rome because that brand of Christianity made it to Rome first. It's, you know, you could call this the Harvard thesis of early Christianity. And David and Lynn and Richard have been speaking about is the fact that more Christological development took place in the first 36 months of the church than in the successive 2,000 years. It was explosive, and it happened in worship. And it happened, as Richard shows, in literary products, that the church's first literary enterprises, letters and gospels, contain this Christology. And that it's important, it was critical to the identity of the earliest communities to have these literary products, these gospels that performed this kind of Christology.
Okay, so in this regard, if we take the microphone back to Richard. And Richard, tell me if this is a fair assessment. And I don't want to be unfair. But we made reference to Bart Ehrman, and Bart teaches at a nearby school to you, University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill.
Greatly inferior nearby school, yeah.
Well,
the inferior basketball program, yes.
Yeah, there are a number of reasons it's downhill from Duke. But Bart Ehrman is not just well published in what I consider almost tabloid Christian books that have these stunning National Enquirer type titles. But he's got some academic publications as well. He did the Loeb Classical Translation of the Apostolic Fathers. He's got a good Greek Princeton degree. And he does the great courses on Christianity, and he's fond of having freshman classes with hundreds of people where he believes he can dissuade them from any faith that they've got and get them to embrace his unbelief as he destroys their views of Jesus and Scripture. Now, set aside Bart Ehrman for a moment as the poster child, perhaps, of what Carey's talking about. Am I overstating the case when I say that there is, in academia in general, in biblical studies, and has been for well over a century, a movement that tries to teach that Jesus, the true historical Jesus, was nothing more than a good man, and that the idea of him being divine is truly not developed for multiple generations?
Yeah, I think that's been a very widely held view it's not unanimously held view, but a very widely held view in New Testament scholarship over the last 100, 150 years.
Okay, and into that area you're wading, but you are not an academic lightweight yourself. You're dean of one of the most prominent divinity schools in the world, and have quite a pedigree. Do you wade into this with any temerity? Are you nervous about making these bold statements that are just so clearly biblical? No. so orthodox, let me put it that way.
Yeah. No.
You are unabashed in your proclamation of this. Have you gotten any negative feedback, or do people just write this off as somebody who's one of those Christians who just happens?
Yeah, Carey and I were talking about this last night. There has not yet been, to my knowledge, a negative critical review attempting to refute the arguments of my book. I don't know whether that's because it has silenced the critics or whether it's because they're just haven't gotten around to writing those reviews yet, or the book's only been out, what, Carey, less, what, 6 months? Yeah, so sometimes the wheels turn slowly in academic discourse, but I haven't heard any serious rebuttal of my arguments at this point.
And these are arguments, as I noted in the introduction, that you set forward in public lectures already.
That's true.
Well, over
Cambridge University, yeah.
Which is, it's not Duke or Texas Tech, but it's a decent school.
You know, the main concern that I got from the professors at Cambridge was a little anxiety about what the implications are of this kind of argument for Jewish-Christian relationships.
And that's something that I want to get into, so maybe we transition that way now. You have, in this book, suggested that as we read the Gospels, we find in the gospel writers a perception or an interpretation approach to the Old Testament that, in a sense, may be uniquely Christian. Maybe it's not. I don't know. But it's certainly distinctive as a Christian reading. And would you talk about that for just a moment and explain what you mean by that?
Yeah, I'll try, Mark. It's the subtitle of the book is Figural Christology and the Fourfold Gospel Witness. And this term figural Christology is one that's not terribly familiar, I suppose, to many people. I really get it from the great German literary critic named Erich Auerbach, who wrote a very important study called Mimesis. Imitation is the meaning, of course, of that Greek word. And he described this approach to biblical interpretation that you find in the New Testament as figural Christology. And what he meant by that, figural interpretation is an interpretation that creates a link between an earlier text and a later text such that one can see retrospectively that the earlier text prefigures the later text. Now, that's different from saying the earlier text predicted something that was going to happen in the future, but it has more to do with saying something happens, in this case, the death and resurrection of Jesus, and then you have a community of interpretation that attempts to understand what does this mean, this death and resurrection of Jesus. They go back and reread the earlier texts, and there's a whole series of moments where they say, aha, or oh, now I see what this meant, or how these event, what God has done in Jesus, is correlated in some surprising way with the story of the Exodus, or with Isaiah's prophecies about the end of exile, or whatever. And it enables them to come to a new understanding of both events, both the Old Testament event and the significance of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. That's what Auerbach means by figural interpretation. But it's the important thing about that is that it involves always a retrospective rereading of the earlier text rather than a claim that something has been predicted by the earlier texts. And I think that approach to interpretation is really quite pervasive in the Gospels.
Okay, if you'd pass it to Lynn. Lynn, and I don't mean to abuse you as our Philippian scholar, but we're whetting some appetite, generating some attention for the fall. You can take it from Philippians, you can take it from Paul in general, but do you see this same approach in the way Paul uses the Old Testament scriptures in reference to Christ, as Richard has discussed within the gospel framework?
Yes, I think that Paul would, my pause is only because I'm thinking about epistles versus narratives, and so it's gonna sound different. Mm-hmm. But I do think that Paul will, he is thinking Jewishly, as he writes to these Gentiles. His churches are predominantly Gentile. And he is thinking about the Exodus as his story and also as the community's story. So in 1 Corinthians 10, you know, this happened in the past when they resisted in the wilderness. This is our story. And this was told to warn us, which I find an amazing claim. And it's a claim that today, I think, when I talk with my Jewish friends, can become maybe problematic is too strong of a word. But you see, I look at the Exodus as part of my Christian heritage because Paul invites me to do that. And if I participate in that, I mean, so what do I do with Passover? And we have communion, and then the Jews have Passover. So today, you know, two very different traditions. But when Paul wrote, he was still thinking about he was still living life as a Jew who follows Jesus, and thus this is his history. I think the complications come today.
Would it help if I gave an example of what we're talking about? I think that might clarify what this discussion is about. Let me give two quick ones. In John 2, Jesus says to the Jewish interlocutors who are challenging his action of overturning the tables of the money changers, he responds to them and says, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." And they say, "What are you talking about?" And nobody gets it. But John, the narrator, tells us he was speaking about the temple of his body. So the text tells us that Jesus is interpreting his own death and resurrection, which hasn't happened yet at this point in the story, as a figural correspondence to everything that the temple embodied and symbolized. That's a perfect example of figural interpretation. But what's so interesting is in that passage, John tells us that the disciples didn't understand it until after the resurrection. And then they remembered and they understood and believed two things, the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. That's an example of retrospective figural interpretation.
Okay. Do you want to give a second example?
I'll give you the second one.
Now, don't blow tomorrow night. I mean, I'm not asking you to
I'll mention these tomorrow night, but just passing. Here's another good one. In the story in the Gospel of Matthew, where Jesus' family flees from Herod and goes down into Egypt, and then after Herod dies, they come back. And Matthew says, "This happened in order to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, 'Out of Egypt will I call my son.'" Out of Egypt, I have called my son. Now, where does that come from? It comes from the prophet Hosea. And in Hosea, if you look up the context, what Hosea is talking about is the event of the Exodus, of God calling Israel, who's referred to in Exodus 4:22 as my son, out of Egypt. Israel's been called out of Egypt. But Matthew rereads Hosea and makes, in this case, a three-way connection between the Exodus story, the prophecy of Hosea, and this event that happened in Jesus' infancy. And he puts it all together. But again, it's reading backwards and seeing something in the text that nobody could have seen in advance. Again, figure.
All right. David? So, I've heard many Christians say that as Christians, we just read the New Testament. There's no point in reading the Old Testament. I mean, that was for the Jews. The New Testament is for Christians. It seems to me that if Dean Hayes is right, that we're to be reading backwards and see and understand the New Testament for what it's saying, that maybe we need to read the Old Testament? Am I that far off?
I think that'd be a great idea. I would recommend it. You know, it is part two of the Christian Bible.
Hold the mic up a little higher.
Oh, yeah. It is part two of the Christian... the New Testament is part two of the Christian scriptures. There's two parts. And I think we need to be reading those definitely together. I actually am a little concerned about referring to things as the Old Testament, because when I say Old Testament to my students, old means worn out, used up, yesterday's news. And I'm on a campaign now to call it the Testament Classic, like Coke Classic, kind of Testament Classic. Because it's don't you think it's a better language? It's in a way, because it is the foundation upon which the new is built. Paul refers back to text in the Old Testament or the Testament Classic about 90 times. You have a list of John 27 times, Matthew 100 times, over and over. There's just this tremendous interplay between these two texts. And if you don't know the Old Testament or the Testament Classic, if you don't know it, I think our reading of the New is impoverished. And there's so much richness that can come from seeing this and hearing these echoes, listening to these resonances, and seeing how these particular texts have been reapplied now to the church and to Jesus, to the people of God.
Lynn's got something to throw in there before we could.
Sorry, yeah,
no,
I was just going to. I was just going to say that I think when you separate the Testament Classic from the shorter part at the end, and now what do we call the New? Is that
Testament Zero?
Testament Zero. Definitely not diet. We don't do Testament diet. But when you separate those, I think you lose the theology piece, which Richard's book brings in so well. And when you don't see the theology piece, social problems can happen as well. That is, you start to have, potentially you can have the rise of anti-Semitism that we have seen. And so there are even social concerns, I think, that this book helps to address and correct.
All right, now I may be jumping outside your area, but I'm hoping that I'm not. Carey, you do teach some church history, right?
A little bit.
All right, good. Then this is fair game. Not wanting to offend David, my friend, but Old Testament, if I'm remembering right, was coined first by a lawyer named Tertullian. And so for you to get rid of what the lawyer came up with is a bit disconcerting to me, but that's okay. I'm going to let it ride for a moment while I talk some church history with
you. Did he charge for that?
Yeah, he probably did. He got a 1/3 cut of the sales of the Old Testament. Carey, so the early church fairly soon, talking a couple of hundred years, but starts being infused with academia, not from Jerusalem and the rabbinical schools like Paul, but instead from Greek thought, the Neoplatonists, and others, as the dividing line between Judaism and Christianity really starts growing after the rebellions against Rome. Within the framework of this, do you see historically the roots of the problem of understanding the Gospels and understanding the Old Testament in a way that is consistent with what Dean Hayes is bringing to our attention today? Or is that just a modern problem?
Well, you probably need to talk about it in terms of time periods, and then just about everything that someone's going to say about 100 years is going to be using a fairly large brush and is open to qualification. But that's not going to stop me from saying a couple things. Really, the place where the Christological debates started in earnest is at Nicaea in the 4th century. Up until then, you had a fairly strong consensus among those writing about Jesus and his role in the Godhead. These are preserved in creedal fragments almost from the earliest documents outside the New Testament, some contemporaneous with the New Testament. These confessions of faith the church would make, if you read the letters of Ignatius, it's in First Clement. You by the time you get to Irenaeus and his summaries of faith, the rule of faith, as he called it, the regula fide, you have these very strong statements about Jesus' relationship to God. And again, as David said, these statements are made in defense of authentic faith, because you do have people on the outside attacking this. You have people claiming, Docetists and Gnostics claiming that Jesus didn't have a body, or that Jesus didn't belong to God. You find these very strong statements about that connect Jesus' humanity and his divinity together. So the attacks from the outside were clear enough for the first 300 years. Some of it smuggled in, for sure, but nothing quite like you have today in the academy. So there. Now, after Nicaea, and the church does really spend quite a long time picking lint out of its navel over Jesus. From Nicaea to Chalcedon, it's a lot of discussions, and it's very finely tuned, and that is an inside the church discussion, and people got in trouble for believing the wrong things. So the more discriminating discussions that happen in the academy today more resemble what happens after Nicaea than beforehand. Beforehand, it's a debate externally with people that are attacking Christianity.
All right, let's go back to Dean Hayes for a moment. Dean Hayes, here I want to fine-tune this discussion we're having about church history for a moment. We think back about the Alexandrian school of Old Testament interpretation, the idea that everything's got an allegorical meaning, perhaps, that's even more significant than the literal meaning. Do you find, and are you advocating, that the earliest church, through the gospel writers at least, were using the Old Testament allegorically? Or when you talk about prefiguring Jesus, are you distinct from that? Am I making sense with my question?
Yes, and this is a tricky question. The original sort of root meaning of, Paul actually uses the verb to interpret allegorically in Galatians. I mean, he refers it to the story of Abraham, Sarah, and Hagar, and he uses a participial form, allegorumena, but he says these things are, interpreted allegorically, but what that just means is in another sense, that they have another meaning beyond the original sense. as the term allegory develops, though, there's an important distinction, I think, to be made between allegory and what I'm calling figural interpretation. Because very often, in some forms of allegory, especially as you find it in Philo of Alexandria, for example, allegory becomes a way of sort of ignoring or dismissing something like the original historical or narrative sense. So that when Philo reads the story of Abraham, Sarah, and Hagar, it becomes simply a way of talking figuratively about something like virtues or character qualities. The New Testament writers, it seems to me, never make those kinds of moves. They always respect that when you're reading a story about Abraham, Sarah, and Hagar, you're reading about actual characters named Abraham, Sarah, and Hagar. You're not reading about character qualities. But the linkages that you get have to do with something that happened once in the past and something that has happened in Jesus that illuminates a fresh understanding of these events. But to go back to Auerbach again, he's insistent that both events are within what he calls the flowing stream of history. There's a kind of historical continuity to the relationship between the earlier and the later text and story. So in that sense, then, in criticism, there's often a distinction made between allegory and typology. Typology is a term that's used to describe what I'm calling figural interpretation. I'm a little wary of the term typology for a number of reasons I probably don't need to go into here. But in other words, I am saying there is a distinction between figural interpretation and allegory.
Okay, you've got your Greek New Testament in front of you.
I do.
If you look,
I'm being cross-examined here, I think.
If you look up above you in that archway, which none of you can see from there, and recognizing I pronounce Greek with the best Lubbock, Texas dialect possible, we read Palaihotheos lalesas tois patrason patrason in tois prophetes. From Hebrews 1. It's not fair to ever ask anyone to translate on the spot. But you don't have any trouble with that one, do you? Why don't you go ahead and tell the folks what that means?
Well, it says, of old or formerly, God having spoken to the prophets, to the fathers in the prophets.
Yeah.
Or through, in by means of the prophets, perhaps.
And so we've got the writer of Hebrews, who's probably reads backwards as well as anybody. The writer of Hebrews starts out his sermon, or whatever we call that book, with a proud proclamation that in the Old Testament, through the prophets, God had spoken to the fathers. And if you continue on with the verse about Jesus, his son, through whom he's spoken in these last days. So we put that in painting above this part of the chapel. And starting back in that corner, we have paintings that perhaps can be interpreted, reading backwards, Christologically, as God speaking through the prophets to us for our benefits through Jesus. You with me?
I think so, yeah.
That, in essence, is what you are claiming the gospel writers themselves have done with the Old Testament scriptures. Is it not fair to say?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think one of the implications, and I end up saying this in the very conclusion of the book, that the only reason why the New Testament writers' interpretation of these Old Testament texts is legitimate, the only reason why it's not a twisting of the texts, is because of the conviction that the God they're talking about is the same God who spoke in and through the Old Testament.
Okay, so here's what I'd like to do. And we've got four of you. Y'all can take your turns. You can fight for the mic. You can fight to keep the microphone away from you. But I'm going to point out what a couple of the pictures are, and I'd like you to talk about whether or not, using your perception of gospel approach to the Old Testament, can we fairly read the Old Testament such that that painting appropriately belongs under that archway? You follow what I'm asking?
Right.
Okay, so for example, let's get easy. We'll start out easy. After the creation of man, who's held in God's hands, searching for relationship, finding it in Eve, receiving the temptation, man is kicked out of the garden. And as man is kicked out of the garden, you can see in the painting the Bethlehem star over man's future. Is that a fair, is that interpretation of the prophecy that we're told is one of the first gospel prophecies, is that a fair interpretation of Genesis? That there will come one who will bruise from the seed of woman. Is that a fair reading, or is that?
So the you're getting that from the I can't really see the painting from here, but from the Bethlehem Star.
Yeah, the whole idea. Do you find in that account of it's this painting here? Do you find in the account of man and woman being kicked out of the garden and the promise that from the seed of woman would come one who would bruise and step on Satan and destroy Satan and, in essence, redeem man? Is that an appropriate understanding of that passage of Scripture now that we're reading it backwards?
I'll start, and others may want to jump in on this. What I would say is that that is an interesting example of going on with a process of figural reading on beyond anything that's actually in the New Testament. It becomes a well-established interpretation in the history of Christian theology. We don't have any evidence in the New Testament itself that this first generation of Christians made that figural connection, but the church did subsequently. And it strikes me as an example of the way that the church learned from the New Testament how to read backwards and read the Old Testament.
Okay, very good. So anybody else want to weigh in on that before I ask the follow-up?
You know, I think Richard's exactly right on that. We were sort of taught in seminary and back in graduate school initially that the right way to read these texts is sort of the grammatical historical method. And when we see Paul doing this figural interpretation, we would ask our professors, is it okay if we do that too? He said, don't you dare, because you're not an apostle. That was sort of the language used. I don't know if that's what you teach at Duke, but that's the way it.
Well, that was my follow-up question. So you've phrased it for me, and that is that fair for us to do? And if it is, are there certain guidelines by which we should be careful, or is it verboten?
I would certainly say it's not verboten. I mean, one of the people who actually said in exactly those words to me about we are not apostles was my former very esteemed colleague at Yale, Brevard Childs, who was one of the great champions of canonical interpretation, of wanting to reclaim the wholeness of the biblical canon as theologically significant for Christian theology. But when I published my book, Echoes of Scripture and Letters of Paul, more than 25 years ago, he got very nervous about it because I explicitly argued that we can and should learn from Paul how to read the Old Testament. And Childs actually said to me and wrote in a review of the book, we are not apostles and prophets. We can't read the text that way. But my argument has always been that if we don't go on reading the text that way, what we're doing is we're taking the New Testament authors' readings as though they were cut flowers. You put them in a vase, you admire them, but then over time they dry up and wither. And unless we are able to participate in that same kind of reading process, we won't have roots in Israel's scriptures.
Okay. I want to echo what Richard has said. It's critical that we continue to read scripture boldly and poetically. But there is virtue in following our New Testament exemplars to create a kind of competency inside of us. Country music writers learn to write country music by taking four stanzas of a Willie Nelson song and then finishing out the fifth in the same style. And you learn the syncopation, you learn the patterns, you learn how to imagine inside of a tradition. So following the gospel writers, following Paul in performing this bold exegesis interpretation of the Old Testament, when sometimes it even looks like a misinterpretation at times, gives us a competency. And then the second thing I would say as a guard, that any move that we're making boldly that doesn't center the death and resurrection of Jesus as a kind of hermeneutical lens, a beginning point for appropriating the Old Testament it could be misguided. That the death and resurrection of Jesus is the very nuclear center point of Christian imagination, and you think through. They're glasses that we think through to read the Old Testament. And if you don't have those, you're not going to be able to, I can't see anything without my glasses anymore. So having the death and resurrection as the lens through which you read is a safeguard for this kind of bold exegesis.
Can I say, too, that I think the community itself becomes a part of the boundary, so that if a person does come up with a reading that is out of bounds, the community is obligated to say, that's out of bounds. But I agree totally with your notion that this imagination must take place within the parameters of the tradition. And when it does, I don't think we're going to come up. I would go to the first window, or the first, I was thinking window, but the first painting, and just think in terms of creation and new creation. Those are the big categories of New Testament sort of typology. I'm not as afraid of the word typology as Richard is. I appreciate the language of figural reading, but I do think this notion of creation and new creation and how that is played out or teased out in the prophets, but also in Revelation and Paul's letters too as well, becomes very evocative.
Yeah, in that framework, I will provide the added insight that I started. I designed the painting, so if you're going to insult it, just know you're insulting your host, okay? I picked these out. I did everything but paint it, which is why it doesn't look like stick figures. I started with man in the hands of God, because to me, he formed man. And there's a denotion of relationship and intimacy in being formed from the dust. We have the fall and the promised redemption through the prophets, but at the furthest reach of the church from the beginning, at the other end of the cross, I pulled a passage out of Revelation that I think echoes and ends the Genesis passage. The Idu Heiskene, behold, the dwelling of God is with men, and he shall dwell with them. And it's the promise that what started and got messed up has been fixed, such that our security is what's in front of us, and that is that God will return. So within the framework of me having been bold in taking this on, I want to ask, my next question is this one, and Lynn, you're not escaping from this, so you get ready, though you don't have to answer this one. You may not be able to see the painting here, but the painting in this frame, this is the benefit of sitting on the back row. The painting in this frame is Abraham offering Isaac. And so we have Isaac lugging the wood. It's on a hilltop, Mount Moriah. We have a ram who's caught in a thicket with the angel pointing to the ram as Abraham is about to plunge the knife into his son who is bound and on the wood. Do we find that as a fair prefiguring of Jesus?
I don't think we find that used specifically in the New Testament. Do you? Or do you think
would
Matthew
would we find
does?
That in John?
I had a doctoral student who wrote a doctoral thesis not too long ago arguing that prefiguration of Jesus as Isaac, as the sacrificial victim, is very central to the Christology of the Gospel of Matthew. For my taste, he sort of over-argued the thesis, but it's a disputed question.
But the dissertation that I figure that I looked at does, Melito of Sardis in his Passover homily does specifically do what you're doing, and it has surprised me that in the canonical texts, we don't have what to me would seem like something really easy to line up. It just makes sense. And in the second century, Christians did start doing that. The fact that it's not, and I'm not sure that I'm, like you, I'm not necessarily sure that I'm persuaded Matthew sees Jesus through the lens of this Isaac and Abraham moment, which to me then suggests we've got to move forward, and I do agree with my colleagues, we do have to move forward, but this represents, I think, maybe a caution that as we do, we'll have to be careful we don't maybe run ahead of things or see things in Scripture that maybe would bring out false analogies. That, and the other thing is, I don't know if this is the case or not, but we've got Christians thinking alongside Jews in the second century, not really sure what the rabbis are doing with Isaac, with this story and that sort of thing. And so that may have come into play in why the second century wanted to talk about Isaac.
Okay, so this means that I've got to send you guys my writing on this, and I got to see if I can persuade you better than your student. Because I would try to argue that this is a not only a fair rendering, I would argue this is what Jesus is referencing in John, where Jesus says, "Before Abraham was, I am." And their comments to him was, "Wait a minute, Abraham's all that old and all the rest of this mess." He says, "Before Abraham was, I am." I think you find that this story in the language being seized by John in his description of that story. And so, but now we're in the dilemma. So how do we decide if I'm being fair and right? And that's, you know, Jesus saying, "Abraham saw my day and rejoiced." When did Abraham see your day? The best I can come up with is the day he was sacrificing his son, and God said, "Stop, I will provide the sacrifice, and it won't be your son." So how do we decide if I'm out
well,
to lunch?
Well, the host is always right. Okay, so do we have that noted? I'm eating dinner at his house tonight, so I...
Thank you, Lynn.
So, you're welcome.
Then, thank you.
I wonder if the fact that Isaac at the end doesn't die, but Paul is absolutely insisting on the fact that Jesus died. He never says Jesus fell asleep or that kind of thing. Jesus died and then was raised. Otherwise, we're still in our sins. I wonder if perhaps it was that insistence on something else about who Jesus is that made the Isaac reference maybe a bit problematic, but in the second century and beyond, we're a little more comfortable with doing that. We can see other things in this story of Abraham and Isaac because we're really secure in the fact that Jesus is raised bodily. I don't know.
All right.
Okay. So now we're getting into it, Mark. So. Here's let me give you another text that I think is the place where I think there probably is the clearest echo of the near sacrifice of Isaac in the New Testament. That's in Romans 8:32, where Paul says, "What then are we to say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? God, who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all." That language, "did not spare his own son," is exactly the language that's used in Genesis 22 mm-hmm. of Abraham's, God says to Abraham, "Now I know that you believe in me because you did not spare your own son." And Paul has deliberately, I think, picked up an echo of the Genesis 22 story at that point. That certainly suggests that kind of figural reading that is in the painting there might well have been in Paul's mind, even though he doesn't explain it. He doesn't refer to Abraham or Isaac. But why does he use that particular language? Paul has these texts in his blood and bones, and he knows where that language comes from. So I think that's a good example. And the other passage that we could talk about is in Hebrews 11:17 and following, where you talking about Abraham offering up Isaac, says he considered the fact that God is able even to raise someone from the dead. So, again, I think the author of Hebrews is suggesting at least the kind of typological connection you're suggesting.
I would say that it's surprising in some ways that the New Testament doesn't make more of this. You would have expected it to play large given the sacrificial act of a father of a son. And clearly this is a miraculous event. I mean, there's so much about it that's attractive. And if I were a New Testament writer, that's exactly what I would have gone to. So it's surprising that it doesn't play larger. I mean, it's a dog that doesn't bark.
But you know, it's also important to realize that the selection we have of what early Christians thought and preached in these texts is a very slender little slice of material. We don't know. I mean, it may well be that when Paul went to Corinth and preached, he might have talked about the story of Abraham and the sacrifice of Isaac, and maybe it just didn't make it into any of his letters, you know? I'm fond of pointing out to my students that if the Corinthians hadn't screwed up getting together for their community dinners, we wouldn't know that Paul actually believed that the Lord's Supper should be celebrated in his churches. It's a kind of serendipity of history.
Thank the Lord for the messy Corinthians.
Exactly. And yet clearly it's something that's very central to Paul and to other early Christian writers. But if the Corinthians hadn't screwed up, we would have New Testament scholars writing books saying that the Lord's Supper was invented in the second generation of Christianity. So we just don't know what we don't know, is one way of putting it.
Okay. And I'm not going to argue the point anymore other than urge you all to consider reading
John 8
again, where Jesus says, Abraham rejoiced that he would see my day. He saw it and was glad. And in reference to that day where Abraham rejoiced and was glad in the Old Testament story, at the end, because just check it out. Okay, my last question about this before we move on. See how you think about this panel. The lowest panel we've got here is a panel of Jacob. You can identify it by a couple of different parts of the painting. You've got him wrestling with the angel by the jabbok, walking away with a limp. You've got him constructing a stone at Bethel, house of God. But you've also got him asleep the night before he raises the stone. And as he's sleeping, he's dreaming of angels ascending and descending from a staircase. Fair? And if so, why?
This one's mine, yeah. Well, in John 1, the end of John 1, is it John 1, 51, 52, you get Jesus referring to this story. He says, you will see the angels ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. And I think that's clearly an allusion to the Jacob's ladder story. And I actually think it's also related to the typology of Jesus as the temple, his body as the temple, because there was a tradition in Judaism that the site of the Jerusalem temple was the same place, actually, where this vision had taken place of Jacob seeing the angels. So I think there's a warrant for it there. You know, what strikes me as you give us these examples is that the kind of reading that I'm arguing for in my book is the same kind of reading that's embodied in the artwork in this chapel, and the same kind of reading that was embodied in the iconography of Christian art through many, many centuries. And it's only since the Enlightenment that we've gotten very nervous about whether that kind of reading is legitimate reading. But by by blocking that out, and as it were, creating churches that don't have this kind of iconography in it, we've impoverished our imaginations. And part of what I'm arguing for is a recovery of the same kind of poetic imagination that we see in the New Testament itself, and not to see that as restrictive, that we can use these images and only these images, but what I would say, Mark, is that what you have done in the creation of this space is a wonderful illustration of precisely the kind of figural Christological imagination that that I'm trying to suggest is already there in the Gospels themselves. And it's a figural imagination that modern New Testament criticism has largely been blind to, because the scholars who have been interested in New Testament studies, particularly from mid-19th century onwards, tended to want to sort of strip all this stuff away and get behind it to some hypothetical earlier layer where none of this imaginative richness was present. And I just think that we don't have any access to such a layer. As far as I can see, going back to the Philippians hymn, going all the way back to Paul's claim in 1 Corinthians 15 that the death and resurrection of Jesus took place kata tas graphas, according to the scriptures, this sort of figural thinking was going on from the very beginning, such that you can't even begin to understand Jesus apart from it. One of the sort of set pieces in my book that I'll again refer to in tomorrow night's lecture is the story of the disciples on the road to Emmaus in Luke 24. And the thing that's so interesting about that is they have heard the report of the resurrection of Jesus, and they just shrug and say, yeah, some women said they saw some angels who said, but so what? You know, we're disappointed. It looks like he wasn't really. And what happens? What does Jesus say? He says, oh, foolish and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. And he goes back and teaches them the things about himself in all the scriptures. And so, and it's not until they get that they're enabled to recognize the risen Christ. So I just think it's hardwired into the earliest layer of the tradition to do the kind of thinking that's represented in the iconography of this chapel.
In regards to what you're saying, for those who are observant and want to see the fun little codes that we've painted in here, we've got Nathaniel painted here in this panel being summoned by Jesus. And we've reproduced the painting of the ladder where we've done it, because it's Nathaniel who Jesus says, behold, an Israelite in whom is no guile, as opposed to Israel, Jacob, in whom there was guile, at least at that point in time, the guileful one. And the puns there are in the Greek as well. Okay, so now we've walked through this. We've given some examples of what it's like to read backwards. We've talked about the importance that this has for understanding Christological significance and an early understanding, the very earliest, that Jesus was in fact God. So within the framework of that, we've got about 15 or 20 minutes left before you guys have a break. And I had asked each of these folks to give me some questions that they might have of Richard. And I did not do it so that I would ask these questions of Richard. I did it because I thought, if you're willing to ask Richard the question, I wanted to hear what your answer was. So I'm going to ask you some of the questions you wanted to ask Richard. And then Richard can comment depending upon how you do. So Lynn, let's start with you. How might Richard's figural reading of the New Testament address the hard passages of the Old Testament where God's actions or words seem to be at odds with the figure of Christ in, for example, the Christ hymn of Philippians 2, 6 through 11, which is Jesus, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a, I think, bondservant's the New American Standard, but of a slave, and being made in the likeness of men, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that's above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, those in heaven, on earth, and under the earth, and every tongue profess that Christ Jesus is Lord to the glory of God the Father. We've got the hymn now in front of us. That seems incompatible with some pictures of God in the Old Testament. You wanted to ask Richard about it. I think we start with you.
It was a genuine question because I had been talking about this book and another book that had come out by Wesley Hill, Paul, and the Trinity. And as I was talking with the group, giving a presentation, someone in the audience had raised this precise question. And so I had gone on to talk a little bit about how in Richard's chapter on Luke's gospel, describing Jesus as Kyrios and stating that Luke's text is, quote, suggestive, that something more is here than might meet the eye on first reading, that is, Jesus's direct identity with God. And so what I was wondering about is, trying to think through, when I think about God of the Bible, I think about God the Trinity. And so, as Richard does very well in this book, he tries to get us to move away from thinking about low Christology and high Christology, but rather just be thinking about Jesus as Kurios, or Jesus as Lord. And when you do that, then you think of Trinity. So if I think of Trinity, and I look at some of the hard passages, let's say in the book of Judges, where God seems to be asking something that in my initial read seems unloving, how would I gain an understanding of Trinity in that? The first great heretic, at least that we know of, in the second century would be Marcion, who solved this problem by just cutting off the Old Testament. But the church said, no, that's not what we do. And that was, of course, the right answer. So what I thought about in terms of one answer would be to say that this God who commands that the Israelites go in and clear the land of the people that are there, that is an aspect of God's understanding of sin and is a warning to all. This is a very short answer. I realize there's a lot of complexity to God's command, and I don't buy the label that God is a God who ordered genocide. But that was what the question was to me, right? So I was trying to answer it from that perspective. I was trying to think of how figurally, reading backwards, what Richard's idea might give me is a way to understand who Jesus is as the judge at the end of time, which is not a picture we get often of Jesus today.
Separating sheep from goats.
Right, that's who he is also, yes. And so, but that's often not preached on or talked about in the academy too much. So that was one way of thinking about it. But I also was wondering along those lines how I would then distinguish that figural reading from another approach that I think has value, where you see a progressive revelation, where God shows who God is gradually to the people, so that an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth is a good thing, but it's not the best thing.
All right.
And so I was kind of thinking through how progressive revelation might also fit with figural.
So Richard, take the baton literally and the microphone, or figuratively the microphone literally, and comment on this from Lynn's perspective. She's fleshed out her question, she's offered some answers. How do you see the tools that you are asserting we have at our disposal for understanding the Old Testament? How do you see those unfolding in light of that perplexing problem? A God who says the things we read in Judges versus the Jesus who became humanity and humbled himself to the point of death out of love and compassion.
I think that Christianity has something at stake in claiming that in Jesus there actually is a distinctive revelation of the identity and character of God, and that as the Hebrews inscription that you have up here from Hebrews 1 would suggest, in many and various ways in the past God spoke to the people through the prophets, but in our time he has spoken, as it were, definitively through the Son, that Jesus is the definitive self-revelation of God's character. And that then becomes, to use the image Carey used earlier, that becomes the set of lenses through which we reread the manner of God's revelation to Israel in the past. That does mean that and this is something I've written about quite a lot elsewhere on the issue of these representations of divinely sanctified violence. Surely that has to be reread in light of Jesus' decision to become the victim of violence rather than destroying his enemies through the use of violence. That's who God is. If Christians believe that Jesus is the definitive self-revelation of God, then that means we have to reread those passages that Lynn referred to in some other way. And indeed, if you look at the way patristic theology usually read those passages, it was in something like the way you've suggested, that they teach us about the fact that God really does judge sin, both in the lives of individuals and the lives of communities, and that ultimately, eschatologically, God will in fact destroy evil and make all things right. Now that's very definitely what I would call a figural reading of the conquest passages. But to me, that's the best way we can read them so as to continue to receive the Old Testament as Christian scripture.
Okay, we're gonna skip you, David, and come back to you after we do Carey. Carey, one of the questions you ask seems to flow naturally from here, hence the reason we're going over to you. Where and how did Christians learn to do this kind of reading? Is it novel? Did other Jews read their Bibles like Christians did? What are your thoughts on that? And then we'll let Richard comment after you answer your own question.
You're very tricky. I really liked writing these questions, and I sent them to Richard ahead of time just in case. You know, I didn't want him to see them, you know, just as a surprise. And
the gotcha bit you, didn't it?
Now I regret all this. Well, I think that what Richard is outlining is novel in some ways. There were analogical communities. There were these highly charged communities that lived over near the Dead Sea. They're responsible for the Dead Sea Scrolls. And when you look at those scrolls, you find charismatic exegesis. This is that. This event is that which was spoken of in the Old Testament. So you find some moves being made by apocalyptic communities, tightly woven. Apparently, it was very difficult to get in. You went through rituals. You believed that you were the saved, and the people living in Jerusalem, especially the Pharisees, were the damned. So we can think of apocalyptic groups in our own time period, where there's a charismatic leader who appropriates the Bible in a certain sort of way to support the community. That's something of an analog to it. So I think that there are some communities and some Jews who are practicing exegesis along the lines of what Richard outlines. Now, having said that, I think that something novel went on within early Christianity. And I wonder how that came to be, and that's really the origin of this question. How did Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, as these literary artists, come up with this kind of competency? And I think you have to track it back to the singular figure of Jesus himself, that he inaugurated this way of reading and appropriating the scripture. And it was certainly accelerated by the fact that communities gathered after the death and resurrection of Jesus and began singing hymns to Christ as God. And once these psalms were being reappropriated to God in the context of worship, it exploded from that. You can track it from early Christian worship experiences of Jesus as the Son of God, preaching in the name, praying in the name. I sometimes tell my students this, that Mark has spoken in the chapel at Baylor. Baylor is still a university, a major university that still has chapel. Our students, our freshmen, go to chapel at Baylor. They don't like it, but they go.
They liked it the day I was speaking.
Yeah, well, they... they did. They loved it, Mark.
Because they got to sleep right through.
Right. So if I were invited to preach in chapel, which they never would invite me to do, but if I were invited to preach in chapel, and I preached up a thunderstorm of a sermon, and I finished my sermon, and I said, well, I'm going to say a prayer, and then I prayed, and as I finished my prayer, there at Baylor, having preached in chapel, I said, in the name of Allah, amen.
Wow.
If I said that, do you think I'd be invited back to Baylor's chapel to preach? Again, no. I think I probably would have a phone call from the president of the university inviting me to come over to Patton F. Hall and have a discussion about why at Baylor I preached and then concluded my sermon with a prayer in the name of Allah. Now, as shocking and surprising that would be to the students at Baylor, that's how shocking it was when people prayed in the name of Jesus in the first century. It was shocking to hear that. And the exegesis that Richard so elegantly and beautifully writes about was shocking. And I think we lose that shock value. And where did that come from? Where did that move? You can look to the side and see other Jews using their Bible in outrageous sorts of ways. But when you look at Christians who are offering worship publicly, regularly, in ways that is repeated over and over again in the name of Jesus, it had to come from somewhere. It comes from their experience of the resurrected Jesus, and I think it comes from the historical Jesus.
Fantastic. Thank you. Richard, any comment, rejoinder?
I mean, first of all, in case you weren't listening carefully to what Carey just said about concluding his prayer in the name of Allah, this was a fictional, hypothetical example.
Please don't start tweeting that Carey Newman... Yeah, that doesn't work very well. Thank you.
I want to emphasize one thing Carey said that I think is very important, and that is about the apocalyptic context of first century Judaism. Apocalyptic Jewish thought, as we know it, is shot through with examples of imagery and figurative kinds of imagery that require some sort of secret key in order to interpret rightly. I mean, apocalypse has to do with the unveiling of something that is hidden. That's what the Greek word means. And so, even though there isn't anything exactly like the New Testament's figural interpretation of the Old in the parallels, if you go to the Dead Sea Scrolls or whatever, not exactly, but it's close. It's analogous, at least, to what we see in the New Testament. And the notion that somehow the death and resurrection of Jesus had been an apocalypse in the sense that it unveiled or uncovered things that had previously been hidden is an idea that could easily grow in the soil of apocalyptic Judaism, which we know from many sources is out there in first century Jewish culture. That's the first thing I want to say. The second thing I want to say is that I'm very sympathetic to Carey's idea that Jesus himself started the process in motion that led to this kind of interpretation. Here's an example. When Jesus confounds his Pharisaic interlocutors by saying, "What do you think this text means? The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand." If that's an authentic saying of Jesus, as I suppose it is, Jesus himself is engaging in this kind of biblical interpretation that forces his followers to say, "Oh, wait a minute. If Jesus is saying that there's someone else whom God the Father addresses as Kyrios, as Lord, who is that?" You know, that's the kind of thing that starts the ball rolling on this sort of interpretation. Would you agree with that, Carey? Yeah.
All right, David?
I think my time's up. I'm not sure. Yeah, Charles, I'm sure you said 4 o'clock, right? Didn't you say 4 o'clock?
We go 4 to 4:15.
Okay.
Something in that range.
We're having too much
fun. This is going to sum us up pretty close.
Okay.
We're bookending from where we started. So, in light of all of this, why have scholars been reluctant to consider the possibility that a divine Christology, a study of Jesus as divine Messiah, why have scholars been reluctant to consider that that is indeed present in the Gospels? Why this reluctance on behalf of scholasticism?
Yeah, you look back at what happens in the 19th century in particular and early parts of the 20th century. They're working with sort of some philosophical ideas about how history unfolds. And these folks are doing history the best way they know it. They believe that there's sort of an evolutionary development that is taking place, and we're moving from one species of following Jesus to another species, moving from a low to a high Christology. And that kind of thing takes time. I mean, as Janet would tell us, evolution, whether we believe in it or not, it would take a lot of time for these things to develop, right? Is that all right? She's raising her hand. So the idea that from 3 to 4, maybe 5 years after the death of Jesus, the execution of Jesus, remember, he is executed. He is a crucified Messiah. He's a defeated Messiah in some ways, according to some. What does that mean? That now they are in the name of Jesus praying and singing and gathering and eating and composing hymns in his honor. That shocking sort of thing, how quickly could that have happened? And people like Bousset and Reitzenstein, others said, that couldn't have happened among Jews. It had to happen where the constraints of Jewish monotheism, the oneness of God, is no longer central. So it can only happen when Christianity moves to this Gentile world where there are gods aplenty out there, and you could just pick and choose your gods as you wish. So I think scholars are working with that sort of paradigm, and I think the evidence really points the other way. If Paul, who is our first theologian, is writing and considering Jesus in these ways as divine, as one with God, as embodying the true God of Israel, as included in the identity of God, all the language that we sometimes use, if that's already happening in the 40s when he's writing, in 50s, why couldn't it happen in the 60s to the 90s when the Gospels themselves are being composed?
Okay, so as Richard gets a chance to comment on that, I want to put my own spin into what David has said and let you comment on it for David and myself. I I look at it as a lawyer. So I got two possibilities here. One possibility is Jesus is a good fellow, bit of a strange duck, but a good fellow, who gets caught up in the moment, maybe a little self-intoxicated over the rush of being the bon vivant, and ultimately gets killed over it. And that's the end of the story. And he had a couple of women who were interested in him, had some fishermen from some backwater villages north outside of Jerusalem, which itself was the backwater of the Roman Empire. It wasn't the tourist Mecca it is today. And in that event, it seems reasonable to do exactly what David has surmised, and that is say, there's no way these uneducated, illiterate fishermen, maybe you got a tax collector thrown in there who's clearly not going to be in the religious know, but there's no way they're going to be able to construct this high view of this common man without a home, wandering, uneducated carpenter rabbi. There's no way they're going to turn him into God with all of this insight into this brilliant Old Testament prefiguring, where you take these elaborate passages and re-understand them. That's going to take decades and decades and lots of people with lots of education and creativity who are doing it for some intent that we can't find, because they're clearly making stuff up. That's one possibility. The other possibility is that this man, Jesus, was God and was crucified and resurrected, and he had a ministry of several years. And he actually talked about what was coming as only God could. And he actually gave us a greater understanding of Scripture so that we could see what God had done and better understand God's communication to us. He died. He was resurrected. The Holy Spirit really did infuse the church and do some of that stuff Jesus said in John 14, 15, and 16 about teaching and reminding and leading and guiding into truth. And the church was able, with great rapidity, very fast, to understand Jesus is Lord to the glory of God the Father and is coming again. The early church may have even thought almost immediately. Am I missing something, or are those the two poles of thought? And if so, why has academia, so much of academia, grabbed hold of the former and ignored the latter as if it's not even within the realm of possibility? And how does your book speak to it? Then we're done.
Well, David is quite right to point to the 19th century roots of most of this stuff. And if you go back and you read what was going on in the formation of what we now think of as the modern university in 19th century Germany, there was a huge attempt to figure out how you could construct a rational religion that would be acceptable to people who try to think within the limits of reason alone. Or you had a theologian like Friedrich Schleiermacher writing books that focused on trying to respond to what he called the cultured despisers of religion. And his solution to that was to describe Christian faith as something that happens subjectively in the consciousness of individuals who who come to have a kind of experience of God, sort of like the experience of God that the man Jesus must have had. So you get these attempts for really on the sometimes on the part of people who are trying to defend Christian faith against its detractors to produce a kind of minimal, lowest common denominator of something that rational, scientific people could actually believe in the modern age. So that's where you get these kind of reductive accounts of Jesus really as being just a great moral teacher or a person who had a deep consciousness of God. You get a kind of Marcus Borg picture, if you will, of Jesus in these accounts. On the other hand, you have the people who are trying to actually refute Christianity and who actually have a deep animus and hatred towards the church and towards the kinds of things that they thought are abuses going on in the church that are created by this fantastic mythological set of stories that are being defended by priests who are basically self-interested and sucking money out of people's pockets. And so you get this sort of, for the kind of evolutionary models that David referred to, the notion that, well, you can understand maybe how this developed over time. So there are a whole set of motivations going on in the construction of these critical accounts that are not simply a matter of coming in a fresh way to the evidence and saying, what's the likeliest account of what really happened here? It's influenced by quite a number of other factors. And it's striking, you know, how much those sorts of views came to dominate at least certain sectors of the academy. And I really do think, Mark, that my book is, Carey described it to me last night as a kind of, what was your word for it, innocent? Was that the word?
Yeah, there's an innocence to it.
Carey says there's an innocence about my book, and my own way of trying to interpret that favorably would be to say that it's an attempt to come back to these texts with fresh eyes and ask the kind of question that you're asking, what really is going on here? And I should have mentioned the one other thing, which I think is equally important to say about German thought and theology in the 19th and early 20th century, is deeply anti-Jewish. It's no accident that you had the Holocaust as the product of that kind of Enlightenment philosophy, because these philosophers and scholars were doing everything they could to drive as thick a wedge as possible between Judaism and the form of Christianity that was being practiced in a modern, enlightened Germany. And I really think that it's precisely then the loss of the Old Testament roots, of the roots of Israel's scripture as the roots of Christian faith, that actually led then to the seeming plausibility of these purely human reconstructions of the figure of Jesus. And one of the theses, as I put it in my book, which feels counterintuitive today to New Testament scholarship, is to say that the more deeply we understand and reappropriate the Jewish context and roots of the Gospels, the more we understand how strongly they are making this claim about Jesus' identity as the embodiment of the God of Israel.
I want you all to join me in thanking these fantastic scholars.